Got it. All right. So like Mary mentioned, I'm Dori Larson. I'm the Electric Transportation Program Manager at the Southern Alliance for Clean Energy, or SACE. Again, thank you for the opportunity to work with you on this really critically important effort. So Electrify the South is a program of the Southern Alliance for Clean Energy that advances the work of SACE. So leveraging research, advocacy, and outreach with the focus of accelerating the equitable transition to electric transportation throughout the Southeast. I lead our work with local municipalities using our Electrify the South toolkit to educate encourage local officials to take actions that would increase the adoption of EVs. And if we wouldn't mind everybody muting, and then we can turn the volume back on when we have the Q&A section. I'm going to take a couple breaks to do that. So like Mary mentioned, together, Electrify the South and the League of Women Voters Florida Clean Energy Committee are working on this issue, and we're inviting local leagues around the state to advocate with their local officials to remove barriers and install incentives that will help spur EV adoption. So the agenda for today is we're going to go through a brief EV 101, and then I will explain our policy toolkit, and then identify and explain three specific policy actions that you can help advocate for with your local elected officials. And then we can discuss next steps for engagement with local leaders. So I'm glad that Mary kicked us off by doing a round of introductions so that I have kind of a good idea of where folks are around the state. And just for everybody else, a little bit more about myself. I'm in Tarpon Springs, so I'm in Pinellas County on the West Coast over in Tampa Bay. So why electric vehicles? Well, climate change is a reality for Florida and for the rest of the world. Transportation fueled by fossil fuels is a major contributor to producing the carbon emissions which are causing climate change. And by electrifying transportation, a significant amount of carbon will be reduced. So like Mary mentioned, we're at this critical junction on climate change, and we need to move quickly over the next 10 years to really make a difference. But I also wanted to point out that it's important that with transitioning to electric transportation, there are a lot of co-benefits like economic development and job creation and increased public health that local elected officials also really prioritize, and we would, you know, be wise not to overlook those. So when you meet with local elected officials, you'll want some background information on what electric vehicles are and their benefits so that you can convey those to them. So the next several slides are intended as a primer on EVs or EVs 101. So I'm also going to share the slides with you all today. And a lot of the slides have links so that you can go back at your own pace and review the slides and click on the links and you know, take it at your own pace. All right, so before we go though any further, I do wanna take a quick poll. I'm gonna look, if you wouldn't mind using your, in the reactions, do a show of hands, raise your hand, or if you are on camera and you want to raise your hand, I just like to see how many of us have driven an EV or have ridden in an electric vehicle, just so I can kind of gauge. Okay, I'm looking through, pausing to look over at the participants bar. So it looks like about more than half of us. That's great. All right. So just to kind of get us level set on the different types of vehicles, this graphic just shows all the different types of vehicles that are on the road. So electric vehicles are a category of vehicles that include both plug-in hybrid electrics. So those are the ones shown in blue that can take gasoline and electricity, or pure battery electric vehicles shown in green, and those only take electricity as a fuel source. So basically, if the vehicle has a plug and you can plug it in and accept electricity as a power source, we consider it an electric vehicle. All right, so let's look at some of the benefits of electric transportation. And the first are that EVs offer significant emissions reductions. So there are two types of emissions associated with transportation that come from the tailpipe when we're burning gasoline or diesel. One are greenhouse gas emissions, and those are the ones that exacerbate climate change. And the second are called criteria pollutants. These cause human health issues, but also environmental problems too, like smog. So with no tailpipe, all electric vehicles reduce both types of those emissions. And I also wanted to address that there's a misconception that the electricity to power electric vehicles is generating as many emissions as gasoline burning cars. And as you can see, that's not the case. EVs emit over 60% fewer greenhouse gas emissions over their life compared to gasoline cars. And it's partially because electric vehicles are so much more efficient, and also our electricity grid is getting cleaner every day. So on average in the United States, you would have to get 88 miles per gallon to have the same greenhouse gas emissions benefits as an electric car. And then I just wanted to reiterate that these emissions reductions are improving every year as more renewable energy is being added to the electric grid. So EVs are going to continue to get cleaner over their lifetime. And then the second benefit are lower lifetime ownership costs. So when it comes to buying an EV, many consumers may like the idea, but there's misconceptions about the affordability. So the purchase prices are still typically a little bit higher, but not really as different as one might think. Kelley Blue Book average cost for an electric vehicle versus the average gasoline powered vehicle is really about a $4,000 difference. EVs are about $4,000 higher, but that's without incentives. Also, research from Consumer Reports shows that when you look at the total ownership costs, factoring in things like the purchase price, but then also fueling costs, maintenance expenses, EVs frequently come out ahead. Especially in more affordable models. Plus, many manufacturers still qualify for federal tax credits of up to $7,500 for a new EV. EVs also have much lower fueling costs. So people frequently ask, what is, if I add an EV to my, you know, and I start driving electric, what's that going to do to my monthly power bill? And it costs about $35 to $40 to drive about 1,000 miles, which is the average month's worth of driving. And gas costs are almost triple that. Also, gas prices tend to be very volatile, whereas electricity costs are pretty, pretty reliable and pretty stable. So the third benefit is convenience. One of the most convenient features of EVs is that you can charge your vehicle at home instead of visiting a gas station. Powering them is very easy. You can schedule it to charge at night while you're sleeping. So you can skip the pump and you never have to worry about a dirty gas tank. This video is created by the League of Women Voters. So I'm gonna show it quickly for you guys. And I think it's kind of cute the way that it was done. So we'll watch it. It's real short. So like I said, that was put together with Deirdre McNabb and efforts of the League. So please share it. And with EVs, there's also no oil changes. So you're going to save time and money. And because they don't use oil, you won't have those dirty oil marks in your driveway. And with fewer moving parts, EVs require much less maintenance than a traditional internal combustion engine. For example, besides tire rotations, the first scheduled routine maintenance for a Chevy Bolt, which is all electric, is 150,000 miles. And then the fourth benefit of, is that electric vehicles are a lot more efficient. So the average fuel efficiency in the United States is 25.1 miles per gallon. And the fuel efficiency for most electric vehicles is over 100 miles per gallon electric. And that's just a ratio of converting gasoline to electric. So what that means is that you're going to use quite a lot less energy to get from point A to point B. And then additionally, they have the same, safety features, and they're a lot of fun to drive. The quickest mass produced car in the world is a Tesla Model S, but all electric vehicles have that powerful instant torque, just like the Teslas do. The propulsion from an electric motor means that EVs are smoother and quieter, and they also have to pass the same rigorous safety standards and often with flying colors. So the technology is superior, powering them is convenient, and that means you're not worrying about, going to gas stations. It really is like going from a flip phone to a smartphone, or, from a rotary phone to a smartphone. So it's, they really are a lot more fun and have that superior technology. So I would like to quickly look at EV projections. Globally, Bloomberg New Energy Finance projects that by 2040, nearly 70% of passenger electric vehicles will be electric. And some great news is that Florida is the second highest EV, second highest EV adoption rates in the country, only behind California. The Department of Transportation recently published an electric vehicle infrastructure master plan. And looking at their high projections, they're anticipating 35% of cars on Florida roads will be electric by 2040. So this is coming a lot more quickly than folks may realize. Also, a little bit about the different types of vehicles that are out there. There are 70 models of plug-in hybrid and full battery electric passenger duty vehicles. By 2026, another 84 models will be coming to market. The average new electric vehicle gets 286 miles of range before needing to be plugged in. And automakers are really decisively pivoting to electric vehicles. To date, there's been $460 billion in global investments in EVs. So it's not a niche. It's not a, is it going to happen? It's definitely happening, and we need to be prepared for the transition. So I also just added this slide from Plug in America so that you can click on the link and you can see all of the different models that are available. It's a great resource to share with friends. It lists all of the current makes and models. It shows the MSRP and the range, and then it also links to the manufacturer's websites. And then I also really wanted to make sure that everybody understood that and many people don't realize that there are electric applications for every class of trucks. So we're talking medium and heavy duty trucks. So on the left side, those are the classes of vehicles. So the light duty are class one and class two, and then class three through eight are all of the trucks, the work trucks, the dump trucks, the school buses, the garbage trucks, the fire trucks even can be electrified, and they have electric models. So, when we're talking about electric transportation with our leaders, we want to make sure that they understand that there's transit and school buses, delivery and garbage trucks, and every kid deserves to drive a ride to school in an emission-free bus. So lots of opportunities for our municipalities to adopt heavy duty and medium duty electric vehicles as well. So I'm going to briefly talk about how we charge our electric vehicles. There we go. The first way is called trickle charging or level one, and that adds about 5 miles per hour. So if you charge overnight, you can replenish what you've used in a day. The second way to charge is called level two charging, and that adds about 25 to 60 miles per hour. And then with the level two charging, those are the types of stations that you see around town. So you'll see them at grocery stores, sometimes at strip malls. And then the third type of electric vehicle charging is called DC fast charging. Those we typically find around highways, and those allow you to quickly recharge about 80% of the battery in a half an hour. So I just wanted to point out that there's two different shapes for the DC fast charging. Nissan uses the shape on the left, and all of the other manufacturers use the shape on the right. Nissan is phasing that out. So we will soon have just the DC fast charger shape that's on the right, except for Tesla. Tesla has their own proprietary charging, and that shape is the same for all levels of charging a Tesla. So that is the end of the EV 101. So I'd like to take a pause here and see if we have any questions about anything that I've covered up until this point. So if anybody wants to come off mute or ask a question.
Dori, it looks like Carol and Sue have questions at least.
Great. Who wants to go first?
I'll jump in. This is Carol. Dori, you I think you addressed this, but it was a little too quick for my poor little brain. The issue with relying upon electricity that might be coal generated, right? You pass over and you said, well, increasingly we're going to clean energy. So increasingly those sources would be clean energy sources. But I'm questioning specifically here in Florida, you know, if we go up to a charging station, how much of what we're relying on with the use of this wonderful vehicle is actually clean energy?
So this is the energy source makeup from the Department of Energy for Florida. So natural gas makes up about 74% of our current makeup. But even with using natural gas, the emissions are significantly less. So this is the emissions that are coming off of an all-electric vehicle that's plugged into electricity made from natural gas. So it would generate about 4,261 pounds of carbon dioxide versus an all gasoline vehicle that generates about 11,435 pounds of gasoline. So even though it's sourced with fossil fuels, the emissions are still significantly less because they're so much more efficient. You're not using mm-hmm. as much energy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm.
Sharon?
Thanks. I was looking at the different configurations on your chargers at the charging stations and at home. And I want to make sure I understand. For instance, you said Tesla has their own charger. Does that mean if you're driving along, you would not be able to charge your car at a DCFC station?
Correct. So Tesla has their own DCFC stations. And what they do have, though, for level two, so if you are out and about in town and you wanted to charge, it's just an adapter that you hook onto the tip of the Tesla and then plug it in and then plug the device from the level two charger right into the car.
So in other words, and I'm looking at the difference between the Nissan chargers and everybody else, is that true basically for any electric vehicle that you would have some kind of adapter so you wouldn't be stuck someplace not being able to charge?
So all of the vehicles can take the ones that you see here, besides Tesla, they've got their own charging network and those are all the same shape. So most of the community charging that you see is that level two that all of the other vehicles, like our Chevy Bolt, my Nissan Leaf, can all take the level two shape.
Okay.
Did that
answer? It does. You know, it's. I have this fascination with Teslas, and this is making me think maybe I don't.
No, I think that they've got a very robust charging infrastructure already in place.
Okay.
So, and with the bipartisan bill and the infrastructure funds that are coming, part of what the stipulation is that it's universally it's universally used. The charging stations have to be. So Tesla has talked about also creating an adapter for their stations if they want to receive federal funds, that they know that they need to do that.
Okay, gotcha. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Tori, if I may step in or make a comment.
Sure.
I drive a Tesla. My wife and I drove up to Maine, the northern part of Maine, and back from Florida last year. Never had an issue finding a charging station. I would encourage anybody who's considering Tesla not to be concerned. Their network currently is more widespread than the other two combined.
I would agree with that, absolutely. Yes, I've taken a Tesla to Knoxville, Tennessee, and back, and no problems at all. The car routes, the car explains where you need to charge. You just map in you punch in your destination and the car tells you where to charge. Makes it very simple. Any other questions?
Yes, I have one.
Okay, go ahead.
Okay. First of all, I just put in the chat that I think this is an excellent presentation. I like the pace of it and the fact that it covers the basic important information without getting too complicated. And as a presenter, you don't quite digress. You just focus on what needs to be focused on. So I love that. But my question is, for that third level of charging, that DCFC, how common are those along the state highways at this point?
They are, right now they're trying to add them in every 100 miles or so. And I'll show you later in the presentation, there's a map that's put out by the Department of Energy, the Alternative Fuels Data Center. So that you can actually visually see and go right to where all of the stations are located.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. All right, I'm gonna get us going into the next section. I don't see any more questions. So now I'm gonna talk about the top three policies. And again, this is meant to be an overview. So I just want to make sure that people don't feel overwhelmed. So please don't feel like you need to become a content expert to take action. And the reason that I included so much information with all of these links is, again, so that you can go back later and become as versed or as interested in, you know, as you want to become. So today, the ask is that you familiarize yourself with the benefits of EVs, and then the top three policy actions that I'm going to talk about. And then schedule a one-on-one phone conversation with me so that we can create a targeted approach to engage your local decision makers. So to review, I'm gonna ask three things of you. One, familiarize yourself with the benefits of EVs. Second, familiarize yourself with the top three policies, and then schedule some time with me to have that one-on-one conversation so that we can formulate a game plan. And I also wanted to share with you, and there's a link here to a Leave Behind flyer that has the benefits that we just talked about on the top, and then the three policies that governments can take on the other side. And there, like I said, the link to the document is here on the slide. So you can either email it to decision makers, or you can print it and bring it with you. All right, so. I think skipped a slide there, or I went ahead. There we go. Okay. So when you do eventually meet with decision makers, you'll first want to explain the benefits of transportation, like I did with you today, talking about technology and the lower costs, et cetera, and then delve into the policy actions that they can take. So the second resource that I'm sharing with you is our Electrify the South Policy Toolkit. So this is a screenshot of the website where the toolkit can be found. It's a digital resource and it curates best practice local government EV policies from around the country. We tried to keep it regional to the Southeast with links to real world examples. So these are things that local governments are already doing. And then we've just created the link to make it very easy for other cities to learn more and then potentially replicate. So like I said, it's a catalog of cost-effective, sustainable, and equitable policy options that local public officials can choose from to support climate and transportation electrification action plans. there's a lot of things in the toolkit. So to keep us focused, I pulled out and narrowed down on three policy actions that we've identified at SACE as being really critical steps to local governments taking. So the first is establishing and transitioning your local government fleets to electric. The second is implementing EV readiness policies, and I'll talk about what those are and what that means. And then the third is being able to provide top-notch EV education to their staff and also to community members. So I'm going to walk through the basics of those three principles now. So the first is looking at fleets. Several municipalities in Florida already have electric vehicles in their light-duty fleet. There are different decision makers with two different categories. So the light duty fleet decision makers are typically, those decisions are made at the city or the county level, but also, you know, some policy can be made at the administrative and staff level that doesn't need full board approval. For example, are you guys still seeing my screen correctly? Sorry. Okay. It did something weird and pulled up.
It's just smaller. The image is just smaller.
It pulled up my.
There it goes. It's getting bigger.
Oop. Okay. I'm going to try to keep dragging that off of there. I don't know why it did that.
I can see it. It's just not as quite as big.
Okay. Let me see if I can exit out. It's not letting me do that. Okay. Well, we'll carry on. So like I was saying, some decisions can be made staff level, like preferences for electric vehicles, you know, those kind of policy decisions. Also, decisions about adding electric transit buses, those are a different set of decision makers. Typically, those decisions are made by transit authority boards, which are typically composed of elected officials from around the county. So light duty fleet, municipalities that have electric vehicles in their light duty fleet are Broward County, Cape Canaveral, Coral Gables, Dunedin, Gainesville, Largo, Leon County, Miami-Dade County, Newport Richie, Orange County, Orlando, Sarasota, Sarasota County, the City of Sunrise, Tallahassee, West Palm Beach, and Winter Park. So there's, and that's not an exhaustive list. So if you don't hear one of the cities that you're from listed, let's make that happen. And then transit authorities, quite a few of them around the state already have electric transit buses as well. So Broward, Gainesville, Hart, which is Hillsborough County, Jacksonville, Lynx, Miami-Dade, Palm Tran, Pinellas Suncoast, Star Metro, which is Tallahassee, and the University of South Florida. So when we're, you know, talking about adding electric vehicles to the fleet, we need to also be thinking about how we're going to charge and how we're going to increase opportunities for charging for community members around communities as well. And so what EV readiness is a policy that requires a percentage of parking spaces built to include electric infrastructure that would enable future EV charging. Requiring EV infrastructure to be planned for at the time of new construction is one of the most impactful, cost-effective options that a city can take to facilitate the adoption of electric vehicles. And there are three tiers of EV readiness. So the first image up top is showing EV capable, and that means that you're adding enough electrical capacity at the panel to support future EV parking spots, and then also adding a dedicated branch circuit to make sure that there's enough power available to the future charging stations without overloading the system. It's basically running an empty tube to future parking spots. The second is EV ready, and that is everything that's included with EV capable, but it's also adding in it's a full circuit. So it's adding in the wiring that would need to go to the future parking spaces, and then also a junction box or an outlet like you would have for a clothes dryer. You know how they're a little bit bigger than a traditional 110 outlet. And then the third tier are called EVSE installed. So EVSE stands for electric vehicle service equipment. And that's where you're actually installing the charging station, plus all of the other wiring and the sizing the electric panel as well. So why this is really important? Two reasons. The first is cost savings. As a percentage of total new construction costs, EV ready costs are typically very, very low. In one study of multifamily and commercial projects, EV ready costs were estimated to cost between 0.13 and 0.17% of total construction costs. It works out to about $920 per parking space. However, if you do EV ready, or if you try to add in charging infrastructure post-construction, costs can be almost four times higher, averaging almost $3,500 per parking spot. And retrofits are really expensive because they require adding the additional electrical capacity after the fact, plus you have to bore it, and then you have to trench it, and you have to refill it with concrete. So that's why EV capable, at the very least, is a very important action, especially when we think about, you know, what we're building today. The parking garages may last for 50 years, and the parking spaces we're building today may last for over 20 years. And the second reason is increased access. So on average, about 80% of charging happens at home or at the workplace. And low to no access to home charging is a well-established barrier to EV adoption. So what this graph is showing you, I know it's busy, but what we're seeing is renters on the right-hand side who live in apartments lack access to home charging, and they have to rely on public charging. And it's leaving too many apartment dwellers without access to the ability to own an EV and to access some of the benefits of driving electric. EV ready policies lower that cost barrier of charging station installations for multi-unit dwellings. And it increases the likelihood of access to home charging, especially for low to moderate income communities, which then in turn increases access to EV ownership. So when we think about increasing access to energy, it's a tenet of energy equity. And we've seen in the past, for example, with broadband interconnection, we've seen digital redlining practices that have led to really a digital divide in our communities as to who has access to reliable Wi-Fi connection and who doesn't. And we can't let these kind of inequities persist as we're transitioning to an electrified transportation system. It's really important that we ensure equitable access to all of our community members. And EV ready policy adoption is a key to that. So as you can see, these are local governments that have adopted EV ready policies, and several others are working on implementing them. And that's what I would love to, you know, talk with each of you about, making sure that your community has EV ready policies. And if not, then we start working towards that. I also wanted to reiterate, I think I mentioned it, the Florida Department of Transportation released their EV infrastructure master plan in September. And part of the recommendations that it includes are promoting the installation of community charging infrastructure, specifically developing EV ready parking requirements. So it's not, so what's encouraging is that the state of Florida is already looking at wanting to partner with local governments to implement these EV ready policies, because they recognize that it's an important policy step to take. And then the third focus area that I'm going to talk about is local governments and ensuring that they have community education and informational materials on their website. And so with this next section, I'm going to focus on what local governments can do to provide top-notch EV education. Sometimes it feels like the Wild West with how we are communicating about electric vehicles. All sectors, private, public, utilities, non-government organizations, we would all benefit from standardizing how we talk about electric vehicles. So one way to do that is to house all of these great points on an amazing EV website. Lots of cities have some of this information either on their sustainability or on their resilience section of their website. But I've combined all of the like greatest hits from what I found from local governments and made the slide called The Anatomy of an Amazing EV Website. So you can ask your local government to promote what that they're already doing on electric vehicles on their website. So encourage them to brag and be their best cheerleader so that the community understands that they're why they're prioritizing clean transportation. You know, making sure that if they have EVs in their fleet, if they have public charging stations or public transit buses, or maybe they have permit waivers for installing charging stations, that they are letting the community know that on their website. So I've linked to the city of Raleigh as an example with the first link. So the second is to provide community members with education on the benefits of EVs. So making sure that people understand the levels of charging and how to charge. And if they want to install a charging station at their home, you know, how they do that. It's important to explain the cost benefits to residents so that they see the value of their tax dollars at work. So I have a link to Savannah, the city of Savannah, for the second link there. The third link is making sure that cities are linking to trusted partners like the Plug in America app that I showed you guys with that website so that people, community members can get a deeper understanding of the different models and where to find additional information. And then the next links are links to federal and state rebates for both electric vehicles and charging stations. So that's a great cost savings that the local government should be making folks aware of. And then the last is a link, making sure that you're educating not just citizens, but also developers, like the city of Atlanta does in this last link. It's a link that provides guidance for developers on when they pass the EV ready ordinance, how many stations you know, are required at a given site and how to install them according to code. So it's great to be able to educate developers as well. And the last thing I just wanted to point out is that it's really important that if cities put this information on their website, that they don't just assume that the word is getting out. If you have the world's best website, but nobody's going to it, then word's not getting out. So I encourage you to find ways as League of Women Voters chapters to partner with your local government to continue to get the message out. So putting it on social media and, you know, if they have a newsletter or if you have a newsletter, sharing and being able to explain all of the resources that exist, just to make sure that people, you know, are aware of all of the information that's out there. And then the next section that I'm going to talk about is how local governments can increase awareness through events or through impactful presentations. So similar to the presentation that I shared with you with the EV 101, that's, you know, really important that if a local government's going to put together a presentation that they have streamlined data that they're sharing. So, you know, I've hosted over 100 EV ride and drive events. We get asked the same questions. Those same kind of things come up over and over. So I've compiled them here. And this is the anatomy of an amazing ride and drive or the anatomy of an amazing presentation for a local government. So again, you can go through all of these links and get the information to be able to build a presentation or, you know, I certainly would be happy to help with that, but just making sure that they include these key points and that they, especially that they understand the emissions portion. Local governments, you know, when they're communicating with residents and with staff members and with business owners and developers, you know, when they're, they really need to be making sure that they understand the emissions reductions benefits to the whole community and how greatly impacts community health. So those are all links that I have about emissions that are useful to add into a presentation. And then someone had asked about where to charge. So this is a link that explains where to find more information about how to charge. So this links to, and this is an image of the alternative fuels station locator. And there's also PlugShare is another website that shows where DC fast charging and level two charging stations can be found. Some of them show level one charging stations as people's homes. when we first started off with electric vehicles, you know, the early adopters 10 years ago sometimes relied on other EV drivers to be able to charge at their house. So that's a great resource to be able to show where all of the charging options are and where the charging stations are located across the country. And also making sure that people understand that, you know, you can power charging stations with renewables. I have solar panels on the roof of my house. So I really truly almost am net zero and basically charging on renewable sunshine, which is really exciting. So this is kind of the end of the information about the three different components to share with your local elected officials. So I would like to schedule a one-on-one conversation with anyone on today's call who's interested in going to their elected officials and making the ask to take action on the three things that we've just laid out. So increasing EVs in their fleet or going to a completely EV fleet for adoption for their local government, implementing EV-ready policies, and then adding EV education and events to the city's website. So we can put together a targeted strategy. I can provide you with community-specific data and resources. I'm really eager to be a strong partner to ensure that you have the tools that you need to feel comfortable to go make the ask. Also asking that you get your local chapter more involved, maybe identify EV drivers in your chapter that would be interested in helping. We're going to have two additional town hall presentations that are going to be basically today's session repeated. So if you would like to listen in one more time, or if you want to invite other league members to join you for the November or the January call, please do that. So the next call is Tuesday, January 16th at 2 p.m. And then we're going to take a break, come back in January on the 18th at 2 p.m. And then you can request access to get signed up by going to the League Women Voters FL Clean Energy Committee, comm@gmail.com. It's on the screen. And then I'm also going to share with you my contact information. So please feel free to email me. We can set up some time to have a conversation. And then I also would invite you, if you haven't already, to get connected with Electrify the South with via our social media channels. We have Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. We also have a monthly newsletter that goes out. So I would encourage everybody to join that. So let me stop here, and we've got about 11 minutes for questions and answers.
Dory, we had a request for the link for the toolkit. If you could show that slide again. That link was actually in the meeting notice for today, but we certainly can do it here too.
It's electrifythesouth.org/toolkit.
Dory, I do have a question.
Sure.
I have been pushing for EV incentives and beginning some pushback. Should I just drop that? Is that just not worth the fight? The $100 rebate, the whatever for either an EV purchase or a charging station purchase? How does that fit into the grand scheme of things with these three asks that you have?
Right. So that's pretty specific because you have a municipal utility. A lot of folks on the call, if they're serviced by an IOU, they don't have the ability to do that as easily. But yes, I would say, Wes, at this point that would probably, I don't think that's going to go anywhere. I mean, it has worked, you know, in Orlando, OUC has, the Plug It, Own It program. So it can work in other parts of the state, but, with what we're trying to do today, we're really trying to push these three, initiatives, the education, the fleets, and the EV ready code.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Sue Gilman has a question.
Yeah, Dori, it's a little bit off the subject, but what is the situation with apartment buildings and condos? Is there legislation that defines what owners are able to do or apartment building managers can do?
Yes, and I can share that with the group as well. So the state has statute that a HOA cannot prohibit you from installing charging infrastructure if you own or if your deed has the right to your assigned parking spot.
Okay.
The issue is with apartments where you don't have an assigned parking spot or you don't own the right to the parking spot.
I see. I see. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Really, really interesting and informative. I appreciate it a lot.
Thank you for that feedback. And you know, I really, again, just want to reiterate that if you guys want to reach out to me offline or if you have follow-up questions, feel free to reach out to me. I'm going to put my contact information back up. There we go. Because I really would like to make, you know, this engagement that you have pretty seamless and not have you feel like you're asking, you know, something that you don't quite understand or something like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, everybody feels empowered to make the ask.
Kay has a question. Kay Hudson.
Hi. So my question is, do you, Dori, help the governments compile these readiness ordinances? Do you provide do you help us provide the local governments with the verbiage that goes into the readiness ordinances?
Yes. So part of the toolkit has links to the actual ordinances that other communities have already adopted. Mm-hmm. But, you know, communities do like to have the flexibility to do, you know, what they feel is best for their community. So some may have higher thresholds or higher percentages for EV capable at hotels, whereas other communities may not want to have as high thresholds. Some communities are looking at EV ready for single family homes. That gets to be a little tricky because typically the codes are done through land development code changes, not changes to the building code. But with single family homes, there is no like land development code that speaks to parking. You know, it's all part of the building code. So there's different pathways to get to some of these policies.
But you can help us help the local governments compile what's right for their situation.
Yes.
And we can do that on a one-on-one with you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So like Orlando just passed an EV Ready ordinance, and I know that the Orlando chapter, you guys were very helpful and instrumental in presenting and coming to speak on behalf of the EV Ready ordinance. St. Petersburg has been looking to increase, they have an ordinance right now just for parking garages, but they're looking to expand that. So we've been, you know, providing data points for them to help them understand what's best for their community, and happy to do that with others.
I thought it just miraculously appeared on the docket.
Wouldn't that be awesome if it did?
Yeah.
I have to give a shout out to Dori. I've been speaking with her and she took the initiative to contact Remedy Introduction. She's reached out to the mayor of Gainesville. I do appreciate that. Thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to follow up maybe in a couple days to see if somehow it was missed. And I may try to go through his assistant as well.
Yeah, and I will keep doing the same.
Persistence does pay off. And that's, you know, that's part of the wonderful work that the league does is being able to get your membership engaged. And if you have multiple people asking their elected officials, you know, sometimes squeaky wheel gets the grease. So. Are there any other questions that I'm not seeing in the chat, or I'm looking to see folks have their hands raised?
I think we have a question. It says, is this for cities only or counties as well? It's from Patty Duncan.
Counties as well. Miami-Dade has an EV ready ordinance that they have passed at the county level. But then that only applies to the unincorporated county properties and not all of the cities that are within the county. So that's why it's important to be engaging at both levels. And we also are engaging at the state level as well to try. I mean, it would be fantastic if the state could just pass an EV ready ordinance at the state level that would, you know, be supportive. So this isn't happening patchwork across the state, but we do what we can do.